As many of you know, I'm pretty partial to shiny and sparkly things. You often see me use Finnebear's Art Alchemy paint in videos, and in today's, I've pulled out all three styles. I'm going to tell you what's different about each, and then demo some techniques I think work well with the line. Best of all, we're putting the entire group of them, more than 60 colors, on sale at 25% off. You'll find links to everything down below. There have been a number of colors added in the nearly 5 years since I filmed the first Art Alchemy paint video, so now seemed like a good time to revisit the line and play with them a little bit. As of today, there are 61 available. Some of them date all the way back to that original release, while others are far newer. The first thing that I want to tell you that you should know about Art Alchemy paint is that it includes three distinct styles. There's Metallique, which is just what it sounds like. It's a paint that produces a shiny, metal-like finish. These are both Metallique. And then there's Opal Magic, which are interference colors, and I'm going to talk about those a little bit more in just a second. And then finally there are Sparks, which is kind of like a glitter paint, but the particles in it are much smaller than what you would see in a run-of-the-mill glitter paint. And those smaller particles really cause the paint to dry to a sparkly, but not as much in-your-face as glitter paint kind of finish. And of the three, I'm sure you can guess, it doesn't come as a surprise, that the Sparks really are my favorite. My inner magpie loves the sparkly finish it provides. So Art Alchemy is a water-based paint line, which means that you can intermix all of these colors. You can bring in other brands of paint that are water-based, and you can mix them into anything that you want, which means if you're of a mind, you can create something totally unique to you and the project that you're working on. So Opal Magic has changed a little bit since the original release. Anything that now has the word gold in the name will show two definite colors depending on how dark the surface is. So if you have something that's, what's an existing color? What's this? This is rose gold. So if I were to put this on white and I were to put it on black, and I should have done that, but I didn't, you would see on the white color it would look pink, and on the black it would look gold. Anything with the gold in the name that is an Opal Magic color is going to look gold on dark or black, and then whatever the first name is that's what you're going to see on the light. But with that said, along the way, these colors have changed a little bit. So these are both Opal Magic paints, and I'm going to ignore this one for a second because this is what I made the samples with. This is called Teal Blue. The difference is now a lot more subtle, but if you look at these three samples, let's put them here. This is, and I'm going back to last week's video where I've grabbed some of the Studio Light tags. These are white, black, and craft from those essential taglines. On the white, you can see that this looks very green, and on the blue in the craft, it definitely looks more blue. So you're going to see that difference, but it is going to be more subtle than the others where it's always gold on black, and you're going to get something else depending on the light color that you put it on. So that is kind of Opal Magic. Now, I use Art Alchemy paint for all kinds of creative work. It's multi-surface, so metal, plastic, and other glossy surfaces, absolutely. For today, I'm going to use it to create monoprints. I'm going to pull out a gel press plate in a second with my dip and dab technique, and then I'm going to grab a brayer and show you how you can brayer it on. So let's move some of this out of the way. Let me bring in, I've got my 8x10 gel press plate. I've got some tags, different tags though. I've got our watercolor tags in size 8 and size 10. I'm going to play with those, but first let's pull in the plate. Okay, so I'm going to put this over here, which gives me a little bit of room over here if I need it. So this side is actually clean. The other side is a bit of a mess, but really, if you want grungy stuff, this is a good surface to work on. I don't want to complicate things today, so I actually cleaned the plate. I'm going to use two colors of Opal Magic, not Opal Magic, sorry, two colors of Sparks to create an ombre background, and then I'm going to come in with a Metallique color and I'm going to work with a stencil. So these, obviously you have to use a palette knife to get the color out of the jar. Palette knives are good things. All I'm going to do is lay some color down and I'm going to make an ombre. And all an ombre is a fancy word for two colors that mix in the center. This is a light body paint. It's not heavily opaque, so if you need more opacity, you have to use a little bit more paint, and it really, you'll play and you'll experiment and see how that goes. All right, let me grab a piece of paper towel and bring in my brayer. Now I need to pull out, someplace here I have some paper. I'm gonna put some paper out of the way where you can't see it, just up here, so I can brayer color off as I need to. So I'm going to start by brayering out the green. Now, if you want to make a perfect ombre, you will brayer the green off first, but I'm not going to. I'm just going to come in and grab. There's enough difference in color here. I'm going to grab the mermaid sparkle, and now I'm going to bring it to the center, and I'm going to let that blend. And that is, for all intents and purposes, my ombre effect. So I'm just going to brayer that excess color off. Now, I could have done that on a tag. I just didn't. And what I'm going to do is, let's see, that's not going to work that way, so we'll bring in the eights. I'm going to put these like this so that I get the color transition that falls on the tag. And by staggering like that, I can shift them so I get more of one color than another. All right, hold on 1 second. Got to go to the printer and get some paper, because I thought I had paper ready, and I don't. All right, so the good news is the printer's 2 steps away. All right, so not fancy, just kind of a cool background to work with. And here you go. So here are the 3 tags. And I'm going to take a second, and because again, I don't want to muddy the waters, metaphorically speaking. I'm just going to go ahead and wipe this off. Now, if I wanted grunge and all kinds of fun, serendipitous things to happen, I wouldn't have done this. But again, for the sake of argument and for showing you what can happen or what will happen when you do A, this way we're not, as I said, we're not kind of confusing things by adding other stuff. All right, so I'm just going to quickly wipe this off. So now I'm going to bring in the Metalik color, and this one is named Midnight Sky. This is Metalik, so it's going to dry to a more metal-like finish. But here, you can see the sparkle in this paint. Even wet, you can see it, and it's just as amazing when it's dry. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is grab my palette knife, and I'm going to put some of this out. Clean that off, and let's brayer this out. And I might need a little bit more paint than that. We'll see how this looks. Because this is not, as I said, it's a light body paint, because it's not super duper opaque, sometimes you'll need a little bit more, so I just added a little bit more. I can always brayer some off if I think it's too much, but I want some opacity here. So my solution is to add some more paint. I'm not going to roll this color off because I may need it. Pull my tags in. Here is one of Elizabeth St. Helier's, oops, here we go. This is her stencil named Chunky Spirals, and that's got a piece of paper on it that's stuck where I set it, because this is the way these things go some of the time. So this is named Chunky Spirals. All I'm going to do is lay this down. Now, I could pick this up with a piece of paper, or I could pick it up with a tag. So, for the sake of argument, I'm going to pick it up with a tag. I don't have any background here, but this will become my background, so that works out just fine, too. And I don't have, there's not enough room here to do anything else, so I'm going to come back with this piece of paper, and I'm just going to press. Now, obviously, I want to pick up the color from the openings of the stencil, because it's going to print on my tags and look cool. But the other thing that it's going to do is I want to clean that out, because that's how we're going to see the background colors on the tags. So let's see what this looks like. All right, so there's that. There are some beginnings going on there, but there's too much paint on here, so I want to take some more of it off. So I will grab another piece of paper. Again, my purpose here is to clean as much of the paint out of the openings of the stencil as possible, so that what's on the background of the tags will show through. All right, that looks pretty good. Just clean up there a little bit. All right, I think we're good to go. So I'm just going to pick this up, turn it face up so that the wet side is up, and get it out of the way. And now I'm going to come in here. How do I want to do this? I think I'm going to do this like this, and like this, and then there is enough room to do this here. So I will grab another sheet of paper and go ahead and press these down so I can print the Chunky Spirals design on there. All right, and voila. How cool is that? The nice thing about creating prints is how easy it is, and then when you bring in specialty paints like this, it really does become so much more interesting. Now, The metal leak, I know I can see the sparkle in there. The metal leak is obviously a different finish than the sparks on the background. So the nice thing is you have some contrast between these two in the finishes as well as in the colors. I was careful to choose a color that was darker than both of those background colors. Otherwise, the pattern was liable to get lost. But what happens if you don't necessarily, let's see where I can dump this plate. If you don't necessarily want to work on a shiny background, well, the cool thing is, and again, if you, we're going to ignore that, that's my phone. If you watched last week's video where I worked with the studio light, the studio light tags, you can see that I used the dip and dab technique, which I'm going to show you in the next segment. But if I hold this up and the light catches it, you can see that the background is in fact all matte finish, and it's the sparks that's on the top that really provides the sparkle, sparkle. But it really, you get not just contrast in color and in pattern, now you get contrast in finish. Whereas here, because you've got a metal leak paint on a sparks background, the contrast in the finish is not quite as strong. But there's ways to be effective no matter which way that you do this. So up next, I'm gonna pull out some other colors of the paint and then I'm gonna show you how to do my dip and dab technique. If you viewed last week's video about the studio light tags, then you'll certainly remember these that I showed you just a moment ago, and they're kind of the foundation that I'm going to work off of today. So the studio light essentials tags are available in four sets. This happens to be the one named Oriental, this is the one named Classic, and there are two others. There's Global, and I forget what the fourth one is. But they're packs of tags that come like these. You get 20 each of the three colors. So this is dip and dab, and as I said a moment ago, that what's notable about these samples is that I used a matte finish for the first two layers. So in the video last week, I used Amsterdam acrylics. They're still out, so I'm going to use them. I'm going to use these two colors are olive green light and turquoise blue, and then I have, this is butterfly spells, which is going to be my top color. So dip and dab is really, you've seen me do this before oftentimes with sprays. It is pretty darn simple. I generally start with the lighter color, not that this is necessarily all that much lighter, but it's just the first one I grab, so it's what I'm gonna do. Now, the thing to know is that you need to spread this paint out. You could use a brush, but you have to clean a brush if you do that. And so I'm not much fans of cleaning a brush, and so instead what I do is I just wipe my finger off and then I grab my surfaces and I start to dip and dab. So that's a fair amount of green, probably more than what I needed, but I'm gonna grab at least one each of all the colors of tags and I'm gonna start dipping and dabbing. And this is why I call this dip and dab, because really that's all you have to do. A little bit down there. Let's grab one of the craft color tags. That's probably enough of that. And then maybe one more white. We'll just kind of pick up a lot of the green that's left and we'll call that good enough. So now what I'm going to do is get these out of the way and just mist this with a little bit of water so I can pick this paint up. All right, bring in the turquoise blue and put out less paint this time. All right, I think there's a little bit of a crumbly in there. Let's see if it, no, I don't see it. Okay, so again, I'm going to use my finger. The thing I like about my fingers is I always have them with me. If I forget to pack a brush, then I'm in trouble. But if I'm dependent on my fingers, they travel with me. I don't have to do much for that to happen. So this is still a little bit wet. I'm just going to be careful. I mean, at this point, it really doesn't make any difference. You can see I'm getting some green in here because if these were to mix together, it's not going to be the end of the world. But if you care about that, then you'll obviously get this first layer good and dry before you come back and you put on the second. And let's just, because we've got enough, let's go ahead and do that. Again, I'm going to wipe this up. Dip and dab is one of my favorite techniques. I find it useful because it provides so many different looks. When I dip and dab with sprays, they look nothing like this. And I like the fact that I have the opportunity to create different looks with the same technique. It just varies depending on the media that I'm using. All right, so now I'm going to bring in some of the butterfly spells, and technically these are still not dry, but I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. Let's go ahead. You know, there's probably enough there that I can dip and dab. Let's just put that to the side for 1 minute. So sparks, my favorite. There's nothing not to like about sparks. Just go ahead, and start dipping and dabbing. And you can see right away that the contrast is really, really strong because you've got a matte finish versus that awesome sparkly finish. All right, let's get that out of the way. Go ahead and start picking up some of these other colors. Now, again, I might get a little bit of muddying that happens here because my other colors are wet. For the sake of demonstration, I'm not going to worry about it. I think it looks fine just the way it is. And really, it's background. So unless you really press and twist, you're not going to blend these colors enough for there to be an issue. And whatever there is, you can always cover with a little bit of gesso or whatever so that you clean that up and you put something over the top of it and nobody's ever the wiser. All right, so that's dip and dab. Now you can actually, let me take a step back. This is dip and dab where your top layer is sparks. You can dip and dab where all three layers are one version or another of the Art Alchemy paint. So let's toss these out of the way. I'm not going to do it, but I'm going to show you what I did. So here, don't ask me what colors these are. The only thing I can tell you for certain is that the top layer is Fairy Wings. This is Fairy Wings, right? It's Fairy Wings because I recognize it, but the other three layers are a little bit different. So if I hold this up, you can definitely see, obviously the Sparks paint is very obvious, but then these others, because I want to say that this was, this might have been another Sparks, but this, the rest of it is Metalik, and so you get, again, a completely different look. So options. Options are always a good thing. The final technique I'm going to show you, and let's grab some more tags, is how to brayer this stuff on. And for that, I'm going to use Metalik Wild Fuchsia and two Sparks colors, Ginger Magic, which is here someplace, and then I'm going to bring the, I'm going to bring the Mermaid Sparkle back. Let's kind of push this stuff out of the way. And I have, this is one of the Ranger Brayers. It's pink. You can see by looking at the end of the roller that it's pink, which means that this is from the line that Dina and Dai share together, the gel printing line. Ranger also makes a brayer that looks just like this, that has kind of a rusty orange kind of color. They're all priced the same. It depends on what you care, if you care about what color your brayer is. So I'm going to start with the Metalik because I've only got one of those. And I'm going to bring out my palette knife and I'm going to put a little bit of color out. When you brayer the color on, one of the first things that you'll notice is that the initial run through of the brayer through the paint, see how it produces that texture that's on there? Well, that texture is also on here. So if I kind of do this, you can see that texture, and you'll also see it when I do this. So if you want the texture, it's a really cool option and it's a way to get some. If, however, you don't want the texture, then what you can do is continue to roll, and then when you roll this on your tag, you're going to roll repeatedly so that you spread that color out in a way that, if I turn this over, if I held this up, you can see that there is much less of that texture visible there than there is on this first one here. I very deliberately left that. So let's grab a black, since we've got enough paint, and just go ahead. So when I brayer color on, it's always at 90 degrees to one another. I'm never going to do this on the diagonal. I just think that it looks better this way. I picked that up from Leandra at Paper Artsy. I saw her demo that ages ago and found that it actually works pretty well. So there's kind of your guide from me and Leandra. All right, so the next color, let's bring in the Sparks. This is Ginger Magic. Again, I'm going to put a little bit of color down. I don't need too much. Well, it's a Sparks color, so maybe we do need too much. Head. Again, I'm going to let this happen so I get my texture the first run through, and this time I'm going to put some of the texture on here. I'm kind of mixing my colors and that texture to get different effects, and the more effects you get, I think the better off you are because it provides lots of interest. And then if I slide this out of the way and I pick this up and I really start to roll, well, now I'm smoothing that color out and it provides an entirely different look. All that done. Let's clean that up. Let's get a fresh paper towel. I'm going to treat myself. And then the last color is going to be Mermaid Sparkle. Excuse me. So I'm going to put a little bit more of this out. Because I've got two warm colors on there, I want to highlight it with a cool color, and I want this to be very evident. So I'm going to be a little bit more generous with this color. All right. Here comes the brayer. So This is a much thicker application. Oops. And I'm going to show you the good thing about what happens when you have paint left over here once I get this on. And then we'll go ahead and get it on the craft tag. You can tell my table has a little bit of a dip in it because I can't quite pick it all up, but that's all right. So when you have paint left like this, rather than do what I did the last couple of times and just wipe it up, you can bring in another tag and you can dip and dab what's left, because there's no point in wasting paint if you don't have to. Now, if you're working in a way that you just want it out of there, then go ahead and wipe it up. But if you're not, then dip and dab. The more backgrounds I have done, the happier I am, because it means I can get to the good stuff. So these are the Art Alchemy paints. This is by no means the only group of creative ways to work with it, but it's a good foundation to get you started, and especially if this paint happens to be new to you. Don't forget, we have the entire range on sale. They're all reduced by 25%.